Julie, we've now heard from both leaders this morning, some key playmakers. I mean, they all seem confident. Scott Morrison was certainly on message. Where do you think they are?
Unrelentingly on message. The polls are tightening, and that does mean it's going to be a close contest. So very different from 2019, where the polls were predicting a Labor win, and then there was a massive swing to the coalition right at the last minute. We're already seeing the polls tightening, so I think it's going to be seat by seat. They are both seemingly confident as leaders, but both camps would be very worried with the low primary vote will mean that independents might come into play, and therefore you could have a hung parliament. And that is challenging. It's not impossible. We have a very robust democracy in this country, and we have seen hung parliaments operate before. We've also seen senates that are hostile to the House, and we are still able to run an effective government.
I wish I had a dollar, Julie, for every person who I've heard say that they wish you were still here.
Yes.
I did my time.
You're not, obviously. If you were, what do you think is the greatest challenge facing Australia's next government?
I actually believe that economic management is the greatest challenge, because we are buffeted by so many external factors out of our control. And I am deeply worried about the level of debt and deficit in this country. We've met global challenges before because we've had such a financial buffer. Our national finances have always been so strong. You know, the years of Howard and Costello, where they boasted about the size of the surplus and the fact that they'd paid off all government debt, we were then able to withstand the global financial crisis, albeit under Kevin Rudd. We don't have that buffer anymore. In fact, we're facing a government debt, according to the Treasurer, of $1 trillion. Mm. Now, you start getting hit with some external geostrategic, geopolitical issues, and we're not as strong as we were. That's what worries me.
We're calling it Australia Decides, but 40% of Australians have already decided with pre-polling and postal votes. So when do you think we'll know who our next Prime Minister will be?
I find that an interesting trend, that so many people are now wanting to get it out of the way, or they don't want to run the gamut of the campaigners and volunteers on polling day, so they're doing postal votes, or they don't want to get out amongst it. I actually think COVID has had a lot to do with that. People don't want to go down to a polling booth. They just want to, you know, go there when it's quiet, post their vote. But this could mean, if it's a very tight contest, this could mean days, and it could be weeks before we know the Senate, because of the way the Senate voting could run. Mm. Although we'll see some early trends. They'll start counting the pre-polling, so we could start to see some early trends tonight. I always think that we have to wait for Western Australia to get there, and that never happens. You know, we always say, we West Australians say every year, turn to the west. All eyes turn to the west. They never do.
Tonight might be a night.
Well, Pearce and Swan are in play for Labor, and my seat of Curtin, which is Liberal Party heartland, is under a challenge. A very strong professional campaign run by Kate Cheney against Celia Hammond. So that's another one of those seats to watch. And for the first time in my memory, seats like Kooyong, Bennelong, Wentworth, Warringah still, Curtin, Boothby, are all under challenge.
Mm. Yeah, it's going to be a fascinating night, and we're so lucky to have you as part of Nine's coverage. Look forward to that.
Yes.
Thank you for being part of the show this morning and sharing your expertise, because it's great to have you along.
Thank you.